Thank you.
Good afternoon.
So I'm sharing with you issues on the study about bilateral PBO pregnancy blockades for control of humanitarian claim, control of malaria and humanitarian emergency situation. I'm glad that the first presenter alluded to most of these, so maybe my introduction is going to be quite short because many of us have heard of these. So yes, malaria is decreasing in a number of areas, but then there are challenges elsewhere. And one of the challenges are areas where, for a number of reasons, there are emergency crises. These would include, if I may continue, these would include areas like refugee camps, where because of a number of reasons, including the changing immunity amongst the refugees, which means from where they come from, to areas where malaria may be high, the crushing of the health systems, etc., it makes these places highly vulnerable to malaria. So we know that IRS, as the first presenter mentioned, is working quite well, and LLINs are also working well. But then, in refugee camps and any other emergency situations areas, the use of such tools are so much impractical. Firstly, because there seems to be improper places where nets could be hung, or improper housing structures where insecticides could be sprayed. And so as a result, we seem to have less with regard to the control of malaria and mosquitoes in these areas. So I'm glad that insecticide resistance was mentioned, and of particular interest in this case is the metabolic resistance, which in a mosquito which is resistant, then with metabolic actions, then it increases the production of enzymes, which as a result, they would act against the insecticides, rendering that particular mosquito resistant. But then luckily, there has been an innovation of incorporating PBO, which is a synergist that helps in knocking down that resistance, and therefore making a mosquito which was resistant to being susceptible, and thereby even killing it. So in this case, we are exploring the use of insecticidal treated blankets as a complementary approach to the control of vectors and, in this case, mosquitoes and malaria cases. And we are saying, in these places where nets have no proper place to hang, insecticides have no proper place to spray, then maybe if these people have a blanket which they use overnight, then those mosquitoes which would come and land, they will have nowhere to land, or they'll choose to land on a treated blanket and thereby being killed. So in this study, which we intend to determine the efficacy of the blankets, we have a number of objectives, including comparing the overall densities of mosquitoes in houses which are using blankets versus those that are not using blankets, and of course comparing the malaria episodes in those particular areas through the use of these interventions. It's unfortunate that we cannot see some of the pictures, but then prior to taking these interventions in the community, we have had to test these blankets in the labs using WHO standardized techniques, one including the cone assays. And the cone assays would allow a mosquito that is introduced inside a cone for a particular period of testing to be able to land on a blanket. And in this case, we are testing whether that particular blanket is potent enough to kill the mosquitoes. But then following that, we took these blankets to what is called a tunnel assay, which basically it mimics what happens in a house, where in this particular assay, before a mosquito contacts a bait, which we used a guinea pig, it had to pass across a material, which is in this case a blanket. And therefore, we were able to test whether these mosquitoes were courageous enough to penetrate the blanket, And those that were courageous enough to penetrate, were they still surviving the dosage on the blankets? And the study in the field, and in the field we intend to, I mean, the study is being done in a refugee camp in Western Tanzania, which is in Kigoma. We have chosen one of the zones in that refugee camp, and a zone which precisely is quite close to the water bodies, the rivers, which gives a constant supply of mosquitoes. And the baseline studies have begun, of course, including collection of mosquitoes using CDC light traps to establish the numbers that are going to people, and collecting indoors to ensure that we get the numbers that are remaining after feeding on people, which we'll be able to compare after the usage of blankets. Additionally, samples of these mosquitoes have been taken, or were taken, to the labs in KCMC to be able to identify the species to the very minute species level and subspecies level, so to say. We did a proportion, analyze the proportion of these mosquitoes for sporozoite infectivity rates, thereby to be able to tell what's happening in that particular zone. So in the lab, we are testing these blankets against both pyrethro-susceptible mosquitoes versus pyrethro-resistant mosquitoes. And we are able to show that at 3 minutes exposure, only 3 minutes exposure in a forced contact assay of susceptible mosquitoes, we are killing over 80% of those mosquitoes. So this is a diagram of some of the assays that we are using in the lab. And as I was mentioning, this is a cone assay, where it's a plastic cone that we have, and we introduce mosquitoes on it, a plastic cone, which allows these mosquitoes to rest on this material here, which is a blanket that is treated. And of course, we would vary the time, but then basically we used 3 minutes, which is the WHO standard, and 30 minutes, which are the WHO standard. We used the tunnel test to mimic what happens in a house, where we baited the tunnel using a guinea pig that is placed on one of the ends. We expose mosquitoes by releasing them from one of the ends. And therefore, before the mosquitoes would contact a guinea pig, which is here, they would have to pass in between this barrier here, which is hard. And before passing, then they'll have to contact these blankets. And therefore, we are testing whether these mosquitoes that are released from here were courageous enough to pass this barrier and feed. And those that were able to feed, would they survive for 24 hours, and whether they were killed or not. So, we chose for the studies in the field, this is the map of the refugee camp, we are going to be working on the zone U, and mine is on U because of these water bodies here, it's constant supply with mosquitoes. There's a hospital facility here which makes it easier to follow up the cases, and that's the case. I was mentioning some of the results that we have got. And basically in the lab, as I tested, the susceptible versus the resistant strains, and we are seeing the susceptible cases, the ones that are not shaded, that at 30 minutes exposure time, we are seeing over 80%, almost over 90% mortalities of those mosquitoes. And these are the mosquitoes which are fully susceptible. Now we are not expecting to find such population of mosquitoes in the field, because basically these mosquitoes have been always pressurized against the doses from the deadliness level soil, and which is why we tested for resistant strains. Please observe that in the resistant strains, at 3 minutes, because of the resistance, we are killing literally nothing in the permethrin alone. But then an additional PBO only acts a bit, up to close to 20-25%. But then if prolonged the exposure, we are taking it to almost 100% when using PBO. Otherwise, the permethrin alone, which these mosquitoes are resistant to, hardly goes up to 90%. So in the tunnel assay, as I was mentioning, we were observing whether these mosquitoes were courageous enough to penetrate that barrier. And mind you, before they penetrate, they'll have to contact the barrier. This tells us that if they were able to penetrate, then they must have picked a dose which would either kill them or intake them. And we are seeing in the control that many of those mosquitoes were able to penetrate, as identified in the bar, which is non-shaded. And those that penetrated, of course, were able to feed, as identified on the red bar. Again, if you want in a permethrin, and these are the resistant strains, that because these mosquitoes they had to be in this assay for the entire night. Because of hunger, they were forced to penetrate, and some of them were able to feed on this insect, and as we are going to see, many of those that
were able to contact the net, I mean the blanket, picked the lethal dose and they actually died. Of particular importance is the fact that permethrin versus permethrin PBO blankets were able to so much reduce both penetration and the feeding rate bar, which we compared with this, determining this as protective efficacy of the blankets against the guinea pig being contacted by the mosquitoes, we see over 80% protective efficacy of the blankets in these assays. The guilt mortality, we see quite high mortalities in both permethrin PBO and permethrin alone. These results, one, they predict what we are likely to be seeing in the field. Of course, these are a number of these conditions in the lab assays are very well standardized, but then they, in a way, predict what we are likely to be seeing in the field. So, preliminarily, with what we have gathered in the field, we see a lot of evolution in the field, basically from what we saw back in 2017, where most of the camp had plastic shelters, and now that we are seeing most of the areas in the camp having mud houses, which are currently being supported by UNHCR. In the zone that we chose, population size, I mean the entire camp has a population size of over 82,000 refugees, and these are all from Burundi. And in the zone that we are working on, the population size is 1,154 precisely, so to say. So there's so much reduction of the plastic shelters in the camp. Malaria in this particular zone, despite everything that is happening in the zone, they are recording at hospital facility level. They are recording over 250 cases a month, which is quite high, despite everything that is being done. We're able to trap some of the mosquitoes, and we have an average per night of 8 anophilines in houses that we're able to be sampled. These mosquitoes that were taken, a sample of those were taken in the lab to analyze and see what species there are. And we are noting that we have about 54% of Anopheles scambi, and a slightly reduction, reduced population in Anopheles funestus. And basically, Anopheles scambi and funestus are the only predominant malaria transmission vectors, so to say. A population of the Anopheles scambi that we have sampled, we saw close to a ratio of 3-1 Anopheles scambi versus Anopheles arabiensis. And mind you, at this point, we may say that Anopheles arabiensis seems to be always categorically regarded as a secondary vector. And incidentally, we are able to record one of the Anopheles arabiensis being positive for malaria. This is striking because we know that Anopheles arabiensis are secondary feeding or secondary transmitters of malaria. They feed outdoors. Then this tells us that there could be some outdoor transmission in the camp. Spores weight rate is in the region of 3%, which transmits to close to around 2 infectious bites per month, which is significantly high in this particular area. So, as I mentioned, the camp is quite evolving, and there has been unusually high sensitivities in working in this camp, which is why you see some of the pictures are taken from far, because apparently some people were seen to have disappeared after they were taken pictures, and either they went away or they were hunted by whoever. And so taking pictures is quite sensitive issue in the camp. So our next stage is to roll out the interventions and follow up post-survey and both with mosquitoes and parasite prevalences through the OPD records. I wish to thank all the supporters and funders and my supervisors. Thank you.
Thank you very much.